So, if you recall, and hopefully, like, everybody recalls DFS, Threads for Search. So, if you recall, DFS was kind of our go-to algorithm for, you know, determining whether two nodes are connected, so, in a graph, right? So, hopefully everybody remembers graph terminology, and, like, you know, you remember, like, let's say you have a graph, and, you know, here you have some, so you have some graph, it can be directed or undirected, right? The edges can have direction or not. And you can have a source, and you can have some destination, and you can use DFS to discover the shortest path between the source and the destination. And the way it works is basically via a sort of flood fill, where you know you first label this with 0, and then you label all of its neighbors with 1, and then you label all of its neighbors with 2, so you end up with something like this. And now you've found the destination, and that's the shortest path to the destination in the unweighted graph. And we saw also that for a weighted graph, we need to use something a little, like a kind of a generalization of BFS, and we saw how we can derive, in one of the sessions, we saw how we can derive Dijkstra's algorithm as an attempt to generalize BFS to weighted graphs, where, like, these edges, instead of each counting as one, each edge has a weight associated with it, and the total cost of the path is the sum along the path. But today we're not really going to be concerned with weighted graphs much. And we're not even going to be concerned with shortest paths. It's just shortest paths before was a way we could solve the problem of, you know, just finding a path from source to destination. So if we wanted to find an a path from source to destination, you might as well find the shortest path, and you can do that with breadth first search. So the depth first search algorithm we're going to learn today, it's actually, in a way, it's kind of weaker. It doesn't really find the shortest path. It just finds a path. And you know, if your problem is also not, like, really caring about the path, if what you want to just do is you want to find, say, all the nodes that are connected to S, or you want to find, you know, is there a connection between S and D, then you can go ahead and use, you know, either breadth first search or depth first search. So depth first search is just an alternative algorithm. It's a little bit weaker in the sense that it does not find the shortest path between two nodes. It only finds a path. Now, why do I mention it? I mean, it, just because it's, like, why do we even bother learning this? Well, one of the reasons is because one of the implementations of topological sort, which is an important algorithm we're going to cover later today, uses depth-first search. There's also a couple other concepts that use depth-first search, and another reason is just that it's a common, you know, it's a common enough thing you see that you should be familiar with. It's actually true that in most cases, using kind of the methods we learned before, the breadth-first search approaches, in a way those methods are kind of more powerful because they can do things like find the shortest path. But, you know, I mentioned this depth-first search kind of for completeness and also because, you know, it's a common enough algorithm that you might actually see it. Another thing that's really good about depth-first search is it can basically be implemented in about like 5 lines of code. We'll see how. So breadth first search, if you remember, already, like, it didn't have the concise implementation of it we had, it didn't have a lot of lines of code. It was like, you know, we got it done in like 10 or 15 lines, right? But depth first search is going to be even simpler. And in some cases, it may, you know, also use less space, and we'll discuss the pros and cons. So, you know, to introduce depth-first search, I'd like to kind of introduce it with a story. And, you know, the purpose of this story is kind of, you know, to show that, like, this is actually a very intuitive algorithm that corresponds closely to human intuition. So let me tell you about how I, you know, kind of derived this algorithm when I was a kid. So there's probably, like, two or three people in the room have like heard this story before, but basically I derived this algorithm as a kid, even though I didn't know anything about computer science, I didn't know how to program at all. And I derived it in like a context where I just happened to need it, or want it, as the case may be. So the situation was that in my school, this was like elementary school, I was like 9 or 10, and you know, I didn't know anything about computer science, I didn't know anything about algorithms, I had never heard of the term graph. But we had like this thing called silent reading. And the purpose of silent reading was just like encourage children to read more. And the way it worked is like you got a book from the library and you kept it in your desk, and every day there would be like 20 minutes after lunch or half an hour or whatever, in which you would get to like read your book. Just every the class would be sitting in silence reading the book. And the idea was to like encourage children to over time read larger books to completion. And there was this book that, there was this series of books that I really liked as a kid. Like, they let you kind of read anything. You didn't have to read, like, really, like, educational stuff. They just wanted you to read more. And if your reading was, like, fun and, entertaining, that was actually encouraged because, they just wanted you to read more. And so one of the series of books they had for kids was Goosebumps. I don't know if anybody, remembers that book series from their childhood. Anybody else have fond memories? But it was basically, Goosebumps is basically this series of books. There's like 100 plus books in the series. And they're essentially like these horror stories for children. So they're not like very horrifying because they're kind of for children. But they do have some elements like, I remember one of them has like a, man eating ooze or something, like ooze that splatters over the city and consumes everything. There's like one that has, there's definitely one that has like an axe murderer, for sure. But anyway, so there was a, where I'm going with this is there was a subset of Goosebumps books that had this really cool concept to it. This isn't like all of the books, it was just like 10 or 20 of the books. They were in part of the series called Reader Beware, You Choose the Scanner. And this is, to this day, I think it's like a really cool concept for a book. So the way it works is the book is written in the second person, so it essentially the story refers to you as the character. It doesn't, like most stories are in the third person, it refers to characters by name, or sometimes stories narrated in the first person, like I, the narrator says I in the book. But this is like, not very commonly seen, second person. So the book refers to you as the main character. So it's essentially like placing you in the story. And then the book is read non-linearly. You don't read it beginning to end. What happens is you read it for a while, so maybe for the first 20 pages you just read it, because the story has some setup and whatever. And then, after like 20 pages, remember, you are the character in the story, there's like a choice, and it basically says, like, if you want to do X, go to page 42. If you want to do Y, go to page 96. So there's like this decision points where you have to make a choice in the book, and it affects the flow of the story. And now, depending on what choices you make, the story may end very quickly, because, if the axe murderer is chasing you and you make the wrong choice, very often you would make the choice and you would come to a page where at the bottom you see it says the end, which usually means you met your untimely demise. Now, most of the stories have like, a lot of possible endings. Like, most of the stories had like 10 or 15 possible endings, 10 or 15 total pages in the book that have the end at the bottom with no further choices. That's considered like an ending. And then, maybe one or two of the endings are like happy endings. And all the other endings is like, mostly you die. I mean, there's a couple other ones. Like, sometimes you get like an ending that's like not a happy ending, but not like, it's not the happy ending, it's not like the best ending you could have gotten, but it's not like terrible. Like, I think there's one where like there's like a genie granting you wishes, and the genie is just very tricky. Like, you request to be like the head of a sports team, and he makes you like head of a curling team, which is not what you had in mind. Like, you wanted to be like NBA, since you didn't specify. And that's not the most terrible ending. I'm sure those folks still get paid all right. I mean, they have their fans. But it's not like the ending you really had in mind. And you sort of clue it, you could have asked for like infinite wishes or whatever, right? So, there's endings like that. So, what did I do when I was a kid and I read this book? Well, first of all, if you just start reading the book and you try to make the best choice at every point, it can be like really hard to actually figure out which choice is the best, because sometimes there's like a choice and it's really not obvious what you should do. It's like, okay, the axe murderer is chasing you and they're right behind you and they're like herding you down the dark alley. At the end of the dark alley, you see an old man with a cane, and the old man looks straight at you and gives you a creepy smile. Now, above you hangs a rope that seems to connect to a residential balcony. And at this point, the story would give you like three choices. You can either run down the dark alley towards this creepy old man. You can attempt to climb the rope, but keep in mind, the axe murderer is right behind you. Or you can turn around and run at the axe murderer and attempt to slip by. So, you know, you might have these three choices. Now, it's not clear which choice you should pick, right? I mean, they all seem bad. let's be honest here. And actually, it may even be that it doesn't matter. It may be that you die anyway, and like you should have never gotten to that point if you wanted to get to the happy ending. But, you know, maybe one of those choices is actually leading to something that's, you know, good and from where maybe you can, you know, escape or whatever. So it's unclear what you should pick, right? So if you just kind of try to make the best choice at every point, I found that pretty quickly you get to a point that says the end. You know, and it's usually not the happy ending. So as a kid, I was kind of a completionist. Like, I wanted to read every page in the book. I wanted to read every page in the book and also find, you know, kind of like the path to that happy ending. Now, the way the book was structured is the choices are not like a decision tree, in the sense that, like, once you make a choice, it doesn't take you to, like, some completely separate part of the story that's completely cut off from the part of the story you would have gotten to if you took the other choice, or at least not necessarily. It could be that the stories converge. It could be that, regardless of which choice you made, like, it could be, like, maybe one of those three choices kills you, but the other two choices lead to the same outcome, which is eventually you escape from the axe murderer, and the story continues, like, the storylines kind of merge. So, in other words, you know, since we are talking about graphs, you know, before I mention how I solved this as a kid, let's just kind of, like, realize how to model this as a graph problem. So, first of all, we realize that, you know, the story can be modeled as segments of the story that are read continuously without having to make a choice. So, for example, if I come to page 21 and I start reading there, and page 21 spills over to 22, and 22 spills over to 23 without making a choice, that's basically a continuous segment of the story. And if I have to make a choice at the bottom of page 23, well, that's basically a decision point. So now, instead of like most books, which are just like purely linear, we can see this book as essentially a graph, where, for example, maybe first I read pages 1 through 20, and then I come to a decision point. And so essentially, decision points send you to different segments of the story. So now we can view this problem as a graph problem, where this is the starting node. This is where you start. And there is some number of ending nodes somewhere. And, you know, it's basically every segment is a node. And the segments of the story are connected by decisions. So if you make decision A, you end up going to, you know, maybe this tells you to skip to page 47, which will go until page 50 without a decision. So this sends you to this segment of the book. Like, we could just go ahead and assign a, you know, these are like page numbers of the book, but we could go ahead and, of course, assign just the number like 1, 2, etc. to these segments. You know, and like, maybe if you make a different choice, B, it sends you to page 97, and maybe that one has a choice right at the bottom of that very page. So these may have further choices. It may be that some choices actually converge, you know, to a shared storyline. And it may be that some segments of the story don't have any choices at the end, which means that it's the end. Like, if you reach a segment and there's no choices there, it's because the story has ended, right? Either every page goes on to the next page, or it has a choice, or it's the ending. So, for example, a story might be modeled like this, and maybe our happy ending is here. This is our destination. This is like our start. You know, this is our destination. I'm not going to bother writing like fake page numbers, but they all have page numbers. And, you know, maybe there's some stuff like this. And, you know, sometimes the story even can go in loops. There are times when the story goes in loops, like maybe if you run down the dark alley, the axe murderer chases you around, you know, the block, and eventually you end up at the same point. And now when you're back to that point, you know that obviously if you make the same decisions again, you'll just keep going in a loop, so now you choose something else. Okay, so, you know, you might even have structures like that, right? So, you know, my goal was basically to, from the source node, find this destination node. And not only that, but I also wanted to do it while basically kind of visiting all of the nodes. So, of course, we know from our previous sessions that, you know, DFS solves this problem just fine. But DFS is not like a very intuitive way to go about this for like an agent that's attempting to do something continuously. Because let's think what DFS would do here. DFS would actually start here, then it would visit these two, you know, one after the other. And only after it's visited both of these would it go to, you know, all of these. Which is really, like, bad if you're trying to read the story as, like, a continuum, right? Because you're trying to, you know, you want to read the story in sequence. Here you're kind of hopping around. You're like, okay, let's read possibility one, and then let's read possibility two. And then let's read all the, you know, all the sub-variations on that possibility. And so you're kind of skipping around out of order in the story, right? DFS allows you to kind of like read the story continuously. So how would you read the story continuously? Well, you know, think of what you would do if you were like a 10-year-old and you didn't know anything about graphs. Well, okay, so, you know, probably what makes the most sense is I start reading the story, and at every decision point, I just make an arbitrary choice, and I keep track of where all the decision points were, so if I, you know, if I die, I can just go back, right? So it's essentially like a save game kind of concept, right? It's basically I'm writing down a bunch of checkpoints, right? I want to like create a bunch of checkpoints so I know how to go back in the story. And then I want to reattempt a different action if my first action didn't work out for me. Yeah, so here's how I did it as a kid. Basically what I would do is I would have like a little slip of paper as I'm doing silent reading. I remember once I got in trouble for this because, you know, we were supposed to be just reading during silent reading, and I was like scribbling some cryptic numbers on a sheet of paper. And the teacher was like, "What are you doing? This is not the time to be doing math." And I'm like, no, this is like how you're supposed to read this book. You try reading this book without this. Like, it's so hard to find the ending, right? You know, I don't know how other kids did it. But anyway, so what I would do is, you know, I'd be reading the story, and let's say I come to a decision point. So here I come to a decision point on page 20. What I would do is I would just jot down on my paper the number 20 like this. So here I wrote down the number, I'll put it here. I wrote down the number 20. And what this is telling me is that if I get into trouble, I can come back to page 20. And why I want to come back to page 20 is because that's where the decision was. Right? Okay, so now what I would do is I would just take the first choice. If I'm trying to be a completionist, I would just look at all of my choices and I would just take the first choice. And so I would go here, always. Like, you know, I figure I'm going to read all of them anyway, so I might as well just, you know, do the first one. Like, I think usually I would first give the book, like, one try, just making the best choice. But then I would probably usually, like, just die, and then I'd be like, okay, I'll go and I'll make the first choice. And so I would go here. And I'd be like, okay, so I'm here. And you know, I would read this segment, and so far I'm kind of reading the story continuously, right? That's the good thing. I'm not like hopping around with the story. I read this, I saved my game, basically. And then I read this part. And now I have to make a choice again. And so now I'm gonna write down this other page number over here, 50. Okay, great. And now I'm gonna make a choice again, so I have two choices, A and B. Okay, let's say I make this one. So you can see that this one is like a choice where I die. So I'm going to make this choice, and like maybe this one is pages, you know, 60 to 62. Okay, so I go here, I read it, and then I see that this is actually the end. So now I want to use my save game, basically. I want to go back here, and I go back here. And when I go back here, I basically remember what page I came from. Like, I remember I came from page 60. And now, well, the choice at the bottom of the page, it kind of looks like this. It's like, you know, here's the page. It's like page 50, and, you know, it says, like, if X go to 60, you know, if you want to do something else, Y like, if I want to take this choice, go to, you know, go to 70. And so now I would remember that I came from page 60. I would look over here, and I would be like, oh, look at that. Since I came from page 60, I know that I was here earlier, right? And then I'll just take the second option. So I would basically scan all of the options again, look to see which one was the one that I tried last, and then I would try just the next one in the order. So here I would now take 70. So I would, you know, I would kind of keep this 50 here because I might still need it if there were more choices later. Like what if there was like a hit Z or whatever. And so I would go here and I would go to, you know, page 70. And then when I have to make the decision here, like let's say here I have, well, here I have only, every decision point has at least, you know, two edges. Well, okay, so here A and B, right? So maybe now I try, I'm at page 71 and I try this decision, and so I write down 71 and I go here because I don't know what I'm going to find here. But then once I read the segment, I'm like, oh, okay, I arrived at the happy ending. And now I could stop, but I want to read like all the possible storylines, and sometimes there's multiple storylines as well. So I would, you know, just kind of keep going. After I read the happy ending, I would be like, oh, okay, cool, I found it, and then I would, like, you know, erase this and return back, return back to this point, and then I would try, you know, the other option. So, okay, I need 71 on here again, and I go back to, and now I try this option. And then when I reach here, I would realize that I've already been here before. And the way I would realize that is, like, technically, from, like, an algorithmic perspective, to realize that you're in a loop and you've already been there before, you would actually have to basically keep a, you know, you'd have to keep another list here of all the pages you've been to, strictly speaking. But because I was doing this as a human, I didn't do that because, for a human, it's actually really easy to recall if you've seen a particular page before, right? Like, the moment you start reading it, you're going to be like, oh, yeah, I've read this before. And then at that point I would be like, okay, I'm just gonna stop. If I see that something is leading me back to a page I've read before, I figure that I'm already kind of exploring it, and I just don't go there. And so at this point, you know, instead of continuing to read the story and getting into a loop here, I would just say, oh, okay, I've seen this before, never mind, let me go back. It's the same as if you hit an ending. You're just like, oh, okay, I've seen this before, nothing to do here. Go back here, and then now what happens here is I'm all out of choices, right? I already tried A and B. And so since I'm all out of choices here, it's time to go back. And I go back to this 50. So I kind of go back here, and now I'm at this point again. And now I'm like, oh, I'm all out of choices here. I already tried A and B here, right? I remember that I came from page 70, and I'm like, okay, there's no more choices here. And so now I backtrack all the way to this point. And now I'm back here. And now I'm going to have a chance to try this path and try to find, you know, more storylines that fork off from this path. So that's just kind of like a high-level description. I will show you, like, the pseudocode to this algorithm, you know, shortly. But, you know, hopefully you have a pretty good feel for how it works. So conceptually, like, what we have is we have a stack, right? We have a stack here, which started with, like, you know, page 20 and then went to page 50 and so on. We have a stack here telling you, like, essentially what all the checkpoints are along the way and how to backtrack. And then, additionally, if you were not a human doing this, if you were an algorithm, you would need to have a list of basically all the places you've already visited so that you know not to come back. So that if you, you know, visit a place you've already visited again, you're like, oh, I've already seen this before, never mind. So essentially, you need, like, a visited map similar to what you had for BFS. And you need the stack of places you've been to. Now, here's the thing. It turns out that because we're actually maintaining a stack here, and we're basically pushing and popping things from the stack, like, yes, we could implement this iteratively, which is how I described it. Like, sure, you could maintain a stack, and you could push and pop things onto the stack yourself. But the good news is, from a computer science perspective, if you realize that pushing things off on and off a stack is similar to recursion, what recursion does anyway, you can implement this algorithm like with very, very little code using recursion. And basically, the recursion is just going to help us like not have to manage the stack explicitly. We'll just be managing the stack implicitly, essentially. So here's here's how we can approach it. So here's essentially like pseudocode we can write for DFS, and it's going to be like very, very short because that's kind of the beauty of this algorithm. That's one of the reasons we even learn about this, because it's just very simple. So I'm not going to do the case where we kind of short circuit, like if we find the destination node, we return early. That's an easy variation to implement yourself. But let's just think about like how do we write the version that visits all nodes. So I'm going to write the algorithm, and it'll probably be pretty intuitive. And then I can like kind of briefly discuss like sort of how do you prove that it really works and it really visits all of the nodes that are reachable from S. So what will be the case is it'll be the case that every node that is reachable from S, like we had a source node here, every node that is reachable from S, meaning there exists a path between S and that node, will be eventually visited by the DFS algorithm. So of course, if there's some nodes that are completely not reachable, like let's say there's some nodes out here, but they're not in any way reachable from S, of course, you would not expect the algorithm to find it, right? Because how can the algorithm find it? The algorithm doesn't have any information about this. So all we can hope for is that every node that is actually reachable from S via some path would be visited. And we'll see that that's exactly what DFS does. Shall we open the door back there? I think it's getting kind of warm or something. It might get too warm in here if we don't do that. So you all remember the adjacency list. This was like a core concept that was covered earlier. It basically says that, you can assign a label to each vertex, like A, B, C, whatever. An adjacency list just represents the data like this. And something like this would mean that, vertex B has an outbound edge to vertex C, and vertex A has an outbound edge to vertices B, C, and D. So in other words, this adjacency list would represent a graph that looks like this. A goes to A, B, C, and D, and B goes to C. So this is in the case of this is a representation for a directed graph, and recall from last time that we represent undirected graphs in the same way, except undirected graphs will just always have edges going both ways. So undirected graphs you would never have this particular adjacency list because this one doesn't have an edge going. This one doesn't have an edge in the reverse direction for every edge that goes in this direction. So, for example, if we had an undirected graph like, just A connects to B, which connects to C, it would in an undirected graph it would have an adjacency list like this. A goes to B, but then we interpret this as B is also going to A and C, and then C is going to B, right? So if this graph is undirected, that's how the adjacency list for this looks like. And then we saw that in the case of BFS last time, that the BFS algorithm is basically the same, regardless of whether the graph is directed or undirected. The only difference is like how we build the adjacency list. Because, in the case of an undirected graph, you just have to make sure to encode that there's a link in both directions, like we do here. Right, like this edge is creating both this record and also this record. And DFS will be no different. DFS also, like, once you create the adjacency list, it's the same algorithm, and you're just going to create the adjacency list in the same way, like interpreting every edge as an edge in both directions if your graph is undirected. And if your graph is directed, then your adjacency list is only going to have your outbound edges for each node. So, for example, if the edges are directed like this, you are going to have the structure, you know, just A goes to B, and B goes to C. Okay, so we're going to assume this representation of the graph. And so, you know, consider a method, you know, I'm going to use kind of a like Python-like pseudocode. Consider a method, this is a method definition, and it's DFS, and it takes a graph, or, you know, we'll be more specific, we'll just call this an adjacency list, and it's going to take a source vertex S, right? So, you take a starting vertex, and you take a adjacency list, and the version of this that we'll do, and, you know, you can come up with, like, other variations on this, like, very easily once you know the core algorithm. The version of this we'll do is we'll just seek to return a set that contains all of the nodes that are reachable from S. And then, of course, you know, if you want to know whether the source is connected to a particular destination, you can just check if the destination is in the, you know, is in the set that we generate here. Alternatively, you could always just, you know, you can add some short-circuiting logic where as soon as you find the destination, you return. And it's also a small variation similar to how we did it in VFS to, you know, print the actual path. Okay, so let's take a look at the implementation of this. So essentially, I start at some vertex S, and what I want to do is, you know, if I have, like, say, these choices at S, I just want to go to each one in turn. And so here what I'll do is I'll need to create a visited map that I pass into a recursive function. So for that reason, you'll see why this works out in just a moment. You know, I am going to have to do something like this, like return, you know, DFS helper of, you know, the adjacency list and S. And here I'm going to add, you know, an empty set. This is like an empty set. You know, just because we'll need a recursive function that can just pass this little value around. And what this value is it's just the visited map. It's all the nodes that have been visited. Initially, no nodes have been visited. So, well, it depends how you choose to implement it. We can go ahead and add the value S to this. Like, we can construct we can initially construct the set with a value S in it, because it's kind of visited at the beginning. It just kind of depends on, you know, whether your code, as the first thing it does, it adds the node to the visited list. Okay. So, and now, you know, everything, all the other logic is basically in this helper, and it's going to be very simple, and it's going to be like four lines. Okay, so now, DFS helper is just conceptually the DFS. This is just so you can pass around this extra argument, you know, because usually when you're asked to implement it, you will have to have this interface, and not like one that has like some magic extra argument to it. Okay, so then here's the actual recursive method we need. And you know, this takes adjacency list and S and a visited map, you know, visited set. And what this does is essentially, first, you try to visit S, so you say, you know, if you want to know if S is already visited, and if so, you want to kind of immediately return out. Oh, are we making too much noise? Sorry. Oh, I thought maybe we were, like, being too noisy. Okay, yeah, that's fine. I thought maybe we were being too noisy. Okay, we have the doors open because it's kind of warm. Okay, so, you know, so what we do is if S in visited, so we want to find out if S is in the visited set, and if that is actually true, we would just kind of return right away. We don't do anything, because this corresponds to the case where I've gone to a page in the book, I've opened, you know, the book to that page, and I see that I've already been there. There's no point in me reading the story. Okay, so we've done this. And now, the first thing we want to do, and I guess we will start with an empty set here, because we're just going to add it here. I want to do visited.add. I want to make sure I immediately add this to the visited map so I can never get into a situation where I visited twice. Right? I want to really make sure I don't visit any, or sorry, this is not S. S is a bad name here. We should call this like the current vertex or something. We'll call it current. Here, the current vertex, the initial current vertex is S, which is the starting point. But as we go, it'll just be a current vertex. So now, yeah, if current in visited, then return. And then visited.add, you know, this is making sure we never kind of hit this line twice. Well, we never process the same vertex twice. This will be essential to ensuring we get a good time complexity and also that we don't get stuck in any loops. So we're going to go ahead and add this to the visited set. And then, you know, because the fact that we got this far means that we never have seen this vertex before, now we are going to continue with exploring its neighbors. And the way we're going to explore its neighbors is first we're just going to recurse on this one. Like, right, if we just went to this vertex, first we're going to recurse on this one and do the stuff there. And then when we're out of stuff to do, we're going to come back and we're going to try to do this one. So the logic for that just looks like 4, you know, we'll call it n in. And now we just want all the, you know, if this one is current, we want all of the neighbors of current, right? So this is just adjacency list, index, current. So basically for each node in adjacency, you know, I'll write node, for each node in adjacency list of current. And then now we're just going to basically invoke this DFS method. So we're going to say DFS helper. You know, and we're going to keep passing this adjacency list, obviously. If you have, like, a graph class, you might not pass this argument. You might keep this argument in, like, your graph class. But here, I'm just kind of passing it. And then here, we're going to pass node. And, of course, we're going to have to pass the visited set as well. Okay. And, basically, if you see what's happening is, as these recursive invocations are made, what is happening here is visited is eventually getting populated with the results. So that's the effect here. Like, this doesn't really return anything here. This one is just essentially helping, you know, these invocations are helping populate these lists, or this set right here of visited. And eventually, your algorithm will run out of stuff to do. So, you know, remember, you start out at vertex S, and here you have if. You know, if the current node is already visited, then return. But if not, then you basically what you're doing is you're just trying each one of these in turn. And as you try one of each, you are kind of like if you go to this one, then the next thing you do is actually first go to this one and do everything that it tells you to do. Then you go to this one and do everything that it tells you to do. And then you go to this one and tells you. Do everything that it tells you to do, and then you would return. And once you return, that would mean that your control would go back here, and now you would be able to, you know, go to the next node like this one, and do what it tells you to do. Now, the important thing to keep in mind here is, how does this differ from just exhaustively backtracking every path, right? And the big difference is that we additionally have this visited map. So what is the effect of this visited map? Like, what would happen if we didn't have it? Well, first of all, we could get stuck in a loop, right? But even if we didn't get stuck in a loop, check out this sort of configuration to build your intuition. So let's say you have the starting node at S, and you know you have a node here, and you have a node here. So let's call this, you know, A, B, and then maybe you have something like this, C, D. You know, like maybe you have a graph like this, right? So what DFS would end up doing here is it would, at first the visited map is empty, so it says, okay, you want to process S? Sure, you can process S. Okay, control goes here, and now it says, okay, now you have to visit every node in S's adjacency list. So first you do this one, right? So first you invoke this call on this node. But at this point, your adjacency list already has S in it. So at this point, our current or our visited set, our visited set already has S in it, which is good news because let's say A has an edge like this. Now, if A has an edge like this, because our visited set already has S in it, if we follow that edge, we'll just hit this case and return out immediately. So that's the whole point of visited map, and that's how it guards you against these cycles, right? So the logic for not visiting S is that S is already on our radar, and we've already committed to exploring it fully. So we're just going to explore it. We don't have to worry about missing out anything from S. So when we see S the second time, we can just go back. So this will guard us from that. But additionally, it also guards us from exploring every possible path. Because if, so you don't go down this edge, but let's say from A, you now go to C. At this point, you would have added A to your visited map. When you first saw that it wasn't visited, you would have like gone here and added A to your visited map. And now you would go down here and you would try to explore C and D. So, you know, first you explore C, okay? So you end up adding C to your visited map. And now your algorithm is over here. And your recursive stack, like your recursion stack at the moment, looks like this. S is at the bottom, right? Your recursion stack is you had a method that was invoked on S, and it called A, and it called C. And so this is your visited map, and this is your stack. And now when you get to C, what's going to happen? Well, this loop is empty, right? There's no outbound edges from C. So after you add C to the map, you're just going to like do nothing in return. And then what happens is you come back to A, and okay, you come back to A, so that means that this has essentially gotten popped off, and we go to D. So then that means at this point, our stack looks like S, A, D. We are right here. But our visited still has S, A, C, D. And then when we return from D, we'll see that we explored all of A's options, we'll return from A, we'll go back to S, and then we'll go down to B. And B hasn't been visited, so it'll get added over here as well. But then we'll try to visit B, we'll try to visit C from B. And it won't happen because it's already in the visited map. So this is how this algorithm is guarding us from visiting the same node multiple times. And the reason this is important, it might not seem like a big savings, but imagine there was like a whole lot of stuff attached to this, right? Then in this case, the first time we visited C, before we ever returned from C, we would have actually processed this whole thing over here. So when we are at B and we have a chance to go to C, we want to make sure we don't do that again, right? That's the point of that. Okay, so you know, you can see that you know this is a very simple implementation. Like these lines almost don't count. Like it's just like a trivial setup, essentially. And you know, like a very simple setup. All this is doing is basically accumulating the visited nodes into here. Now, sure, you could have some logic where you say like, oh, and if you see the destination node here, like before you do the recursion, you could say if you had a destination parameter d over here, you could say like right over here, you could insert a line that says, you know, if node equals D, you know, if node equals D, then return, and you could have a little bit of logic, you know, here that basically checks the return value of any methods you call, and if any one of your sub-methods return, then you return overall. So, you know, okay, I guess I'll just show this variation to make sure you know how to do it. It would just be something like this. You would have to basically be returning a boolean here to indicate, like whenever you return here, you would return a boolean to indicate if you've found it already. And if you have not found it already, well, and if you have found it already, you'd want to kind of like immediately unwind the stack. You'd want to immediately return out. So what you would do here is you would say something like, if node equals d, then return, you know, return true or whatever, and if now you would basically like call this DFS function, you would say like, if DFS helper, of all that stuff, adjacency, node, and visited. So in other words, if the node is not already your destination node, then you want to do that stuff. And if that returns true, then if one of these helpers returns true, then you immediately want to return true, just so that like you don't do anything else. And then if none of these return true, then you return false at the end of this loop. In either case, you'll have updated, essentially this. This function will have updated the visited map with whatever nodes you wanted to visit. So this is kind of like, as long as things are returning false, as long as this case is like not getting hit, what would be happening is you would just be doing the algorithm as before. But if this case is hit, what would happen is the method would immediately return. And then the method that called it here, like the method that called this, version of the recursive method would get a true value here, and it would itself return true. And that would basically unwind the stack. So, I mean, if you're not like super comfortable with recursion, this may be like a little harder to make sense of. But hopefully, you're pretty comfortable with recursion. So if you have a recursive stack here, like S, A, B, C, and S, and C finds, the node D, and this triggers that condition, because C invoked it here, this will immediately return true, and the stack will end up just unwinding right away very quickly, and you will get your, false. The visited set you will get is just like a partial visited set that is all the things you visited before you found it. Okay, so this is basically the DFS algorithm. So it's important to know this algorithm. It's important to, it comes up a lot. You see it often enough. It's good to know. Good to know some variations on it, like, how to go to the destination node. I guess one more common variation is how do you actually recover the path between the source and the destination, right? If you wanted to find a path to a specific destination, how do you recover that path? How you recover the path is you would just kind of store some additional stuff in your data structures here. So in your visited map, instead of having like just a visited set, what you could do is you could make it a visited map where you are mapping each node that is visited to the node you came from to visit it. So instead of doing something like visited.add here, visited would be a map. And you would do something like, visited of current, and, you would do something like visited of current equals the node you came from. So, okay, maybe you need to, there's other ways to do this, but maybe you could pass a parameter here called, parent, and this is just the node you came from. And the only purpose of this is that, if this condition hits, you would put something like this here. And in every other way, it works the same way. But what you're really doing here is you're just also, for each node that you're visiting, instead of just marking it as visited, you're also marking down what its parent is. And once you, like, you're basically saying, what node did you come from to visit this node? And then if you have constructed this kind of parent map, then you can just use it to backtrace the path. After your algorithm is done, you can say, take my destination. What is the destination's parent? Take that, the parent of that, take the parent of that, and so on until you reach the source. And the source is the only node that doesn't have a parent, right? So eventually, it must be the case that eventually you get back to the source, because the source is the only node that doesn't have a parent. The parent of source is null. And when you see that you've gotten back to the source you saw, this is very similar to how you backtrack and find the path in the BFS algorithm. So if you understood the BFS material pretty well, this should be like pretty obvious how to recover the path, because it's the same. It's the same way. You're going to store, you're going to associate with every node a parent that you came from. You can either use an extra data structure, or you can just reuse the visited map in this way. Okay, so I'm going to stop and take any questions you might have on DFS. Does anybody have questions on DFS? Yep.
So the sec directly adjacent to the
oh yeah. Sorry, I didn't edit this. Once we go to this format where we actually need to sort a pair, this is of course a dictionary here. Yeah, this is a dictionary. Oh, even in the earlier variation, yeah, we could have gone with a dictionary. I mean, there's no point. Like, you're not doing anything with the dictionary capability. You're just, you know. Yeah, you wouldn't really be doing anything with the dictionary at that point, but sure, like, a dictionary is a generalization of a set, so you could, you know, just fill every value with true and, you know, just refer to the keys of the dictionary.
In a set?
No, a set also guards against duplicates, just like a dictionary does. The whole point of both sets and dictionaries is to associate unique keys with values. Or in the case of set, just the existence, registering the existence of unique keys. I mean, internally, actually, like, there were even some languages where internally sets were implemented using dictionaries or vice versa. You know, because they're kind of doing the same thing, they're both probably using a hash table under the hood. They're actually very similar. Not really like a whole lot of difference. It's just like a dictionary is basically just attaching an associated like extra data item with every key.
The input
Bluetooth
can it be?
What?
Okay.
We can. Yeah. We haven't gotten to that yet, but we will look at it. We will look at that. And that's exactly that kind of eventually leads into the top of directed acyclic graphs and topological sort.
Do you happen to
Wi-Fi password?
Yeah.
I do not.
Would there be a case where you're going to put a parent and no definition in adjacent to
Yeah. So the question was like, do you have to use a visited map necessarily? And the answer is no, not if you can add extra attributes to the nodes themselves. Yeah, there's a classic puzzle problem that's related to this, which is like, the problem of like you're stuck in a maze and you have to find your way out, right? So hopefully you know this problem. So you've probably like heard of this before. So essentially, there's a bunch of you're in a maze. And there's a bunch of rooms that are basically connected by passages. So you can kind of already see that this is essentially a graph. Like, this passage is essentially an edge. So you're in a maze, and the maze is modeled as a bunch of rooms that are connected by passages. And you start at some starting node, and you have to find your way out. And the reason, you want to use kind of DFS here, and not BFS, is just because if you are like a person that is searching, there's not really any good way you can do BFS. Or you can do it, but it's not very good, right? Because how would you use breadth first search here? So let's say this is your destination. How would you find this using breadth first search? You'd first have to visit these two nodes, right? So you'd kind of have to like walk over here, and then walk back, and then come over here, right? And then to visit the second level, you'd have to come all the way back over here, and then come all the way back over here, right? So you can see that, like, for a robot or something, or like if you have like a robot moving about an environment, or you're doing this algorithm with your own person, you might want to use something more like DFS, because DFS has the property of continuity, right? You're following essentially a path continuously until you can't do it anymore, and then you backtrack. So this is kind of a very similar problem, but I just want to kind of frame it in this way so that you can see, how else you can do it rather than having a separate visited map structure. So in practical terms, doing it with the visited map like I showed is usually the better option because you don't have to modify the original underlying graph. And in some languages like JavaScript, you can just add whatever you want to nodes. But in other languages, like, if the original graph you're given only has certain fields and it doesn't have like a temporary field you can use for your DFS, it doesn't have like a is visited field, then you would have to like first copy the graph and then you would, you know, introduce that field and then use that field if you wanted to use a field in the node. But let's think about how, like, how you could do it essentially as a human. So usually the thought process is that you want to, like, drag a thread behind you or something. You know, you essentially want to drag a thread behind you, and that essentially corresponds to your stack. That is like your backtracking mechanism. The thread you're dragging behind you allows you to walk back. So that is essentially equivalent to the stack. So you're dragging a thread behind you, which essentially is the stack and allows you to like push and pop at any time. And additionally, you have a can of paint. In this formulation of the problem, you have a can of paint. And what you do is every time you reach a room for the first time, you just kind of spray it. You like spray the floor. And that's essentially equivalent to marking the node as distant. And then from there, it's the same DFS algorithm. And that's how you kind of solve that logic problem. I think like that logic problem was even asked to like non-computer science majors at like, you know, like some of those like business interviews where like business school graduates. There used to be a thing where like, I don't know if they still do this, but like some firms used to ask like business school graduates applying for like, you know, various like strategist positions, these kind of like logic puzzles, like a lot of which are like of the kind that are banned for for software engineers at most companies, like, you know, how many golf balls can fit in the bus, how many cockroaches are there in London, you know, problems like that that are, like, not very good software engineering problems. But, you know, they would also ask you that problem about, like, how do you get, like, a goat, a fox, and whatever to cross a river, if you've heard that one before. And, you know, they would actually ask people stuff like this, like, you, like not like given a graph, but like, you're in a maze, and you have a rope, and you have a can of paint, how can you find your way out? And you'd have to kind of like try to reason it out. And it's basically this algorithm, that's what it is. You know, the point is, you want to use the can of paint to mark places where you've already been, so you don't get stuck in loops, going round and round. And, you know, you want to carry a thread behind you so that you can backtrack. And then you basically execute thread first search. And in this case, essentially, is visited is not being stored in a separate map in your head. Is visited is basically a property of the node. It's whether the node is marked or not. So in some implementations of DFS, you actually see that. You see basically like a node marking algorithm, where instead of using the visited map, each node is either marked or unmarked. Okay. And as you'll see, sometimes the nodes have three colors. Sometimes they do white, black, and gray. But as of right now, you have no need for the three colors yet. You'll see what the three colors are used for later. It's basically two different kinds of marking, and that helps you do stuff like detect cycles. But in the case where where you only need one kind of marking, you know, either marked or unmarked, in the case of where you're just trying to find your way to a destination or trying to visit all the nodes in the graph. Okay, any further questions in the DFS? And then I will talk a little bit about cycles and how to detect them using DFS. Yep?
So I have a problem of reading up keys to a loss.
A what?
A key. So you have to write the keys to lock the lock.
Oh, I know that problem. That's a little different. I mean, okay, there's a couple of different versions of that problem, and what kind of problem it is really depends on which specific version you're referring to. I don't think that's really relevant, like, right now.
So can we solve using DFS? That was my question.
Depends which version of the problem you have, but, like, the answer is maybe. It depends on what, like, sub-variation of that problem you have. But don't worry about it right now. Maybe we'll do a problem like that in like some later problem solving. Okay. Yeah, the question was about like a specific problem, which I'm not going to do like right this moment. Okay. So the next thing I want to cover is the concept of cycles and graphs. And at first, you might not really get why it's like particularly meaningful whether a graph has a cycle or not. And that's coming up in basically the topological sort. When we see topological sort, we'll see why it's very important whether a graph has a cycle or not. But for now, let's just kind of talk about what a cycle in a graph is. So a cycle in a graph, intuitively, is just something like this. So essentially, it is a loop in the cycle. It is a path which comes back to the vertex where it starts. So here's the path. So this path is a cycle. Now, we say a graph has a cycle if it contains at least one cycle that we can mention. If a graph doesn't have any cycles, then we call it an acyclic graph. Now, we have to be careful how we apply. So in the case of a directed graph, it really is just this definition. In the case of an undirected graph, we got to be a little bit wary about how we apply that concept. Because, well, let's take a look. So you could easily claim that this undirected graph has a cycle. But that doesn't seem very interesting, because then every undirected graph has a cycle, as long as it has at least one edge. You wouldn't want the definition for an undirected graph to be that, because this is kind of like not really expressing anything about the graph. Like, almost every graph has a cycle. Why does it have a cycle? Well, you know, because after all, you know, we can do this as many times as we want, right? So you get the idea that, like, for a directed graph, that kind of seems fair game. For a directed graph, if you go to A, if you go from A to B, and then there actually exists an edge from B to A, maybe it's fair to say that that's a cycle, because in a directed graph, it could very well be that there's no such edge. But in an undirected graph, you don't want this definition. So, generally for an undirected graph, you want to say there's a cycle only if, you know, you can start at some node, and you can, you know, visit at least three distinct nodes before you come back. Like, you know, if you have something like that, you call it a cycle. But that way, you can visit three distinct, you have to visit at least three distinct nodes before you crisscross, you know, any node that you've seen before. So, like, in other words, this would not be a cycle either. Like, even though this has, like, A, B, and C, you basically have to come back to A before you know, visit any node again. So this doesn't count. You know, this doesn't count. You would actually have to come back to A directly. So like for an undirected graph, you require that every node in the cycle be unique up until you return to the original starting point. So because you don't want to count something like this, right? Because then you would say this has a cycle because you're doing 1, 2, 3, you know, and then you're coming back. I think it's fairly straightforward, like, why you want this definition, because otherwise everything has a cycle trivially, right? So in the case of an undirected graph, it actually turns out to be, well, pretty simple to detect cycles. You don't need to use DFS or anything like that. DFS offers you kind of like no real advantage. How would you detect the cycle for an undirected graph, do you think? Well, you know, the idea is basically just to use DFS. And if you ever reach the same node from two different places, then you know that it has a cycle. Like, what you would do is, like, for example, let's say you started A. You know, so here's your DFS. So B and C are both visited from A. And you know, so at this point, the parent of B is already A. You've already established that you reached B from A, and you've established that you reached C from A. And now when B and C try to reach each other, you would see that, okay, actually a node is being reached from multiple places, and you know, that doesn't count. And the only thing you have to be careful about is something like this. Let's say, so this graph actually is considered not to have any cycles. It's a tree. And one of the reasons why, you know, we even talk about the concept of cycles in an undirected graph is because there's basically a fairly easy to prove theorem that we're not going to like prove here, but it says that basically if for an undirected graph, this is not true for a directed graph as we'll see in detail, but if for an undirected graph you are cycle free according to the definition of cycles I just gave, where you know you actually have to find like a real ring. You have to find a loop. If you are cycle free, then your graph is a collection of trees. Why do I say a collection? Because your graph might not be connected, right? So this graph right here, is actually cycle 3, but it's not a tree, it's actually a collection of trees. Like, you know, something like this is a collection of trees. They call it a forest. Right? It's not a single tree. And it's still cycle 3, and that's okay. But yeah, any graph that is cycle 3 for an undirected graph is a forest of trees. So sometimes that's a useful property because, as you might well be aware, there's a lot of, like, you know, kind of algorithms you can do on trees, right? There's a lot of, like, different things you can do to trees. So sometimes if you know that your graph is, you know, undirected and cycle free, that means you can actually split your graph into, if you find the connected components of the graph, each connected component is a tree. And then you can maybe solve the problem one tree at a time. This comes up in some context, so I wanted to mention it. I don't want to, like, take the time to, like, stop and provide an example for this because it's kind of a side point, but it is a good thing to know, so I thought I'd mention it. So yes, how do we find for an undirected graph whether it has a cycle or not? So let's say we have a tree like this. What we can do is we start exploring for, like, any node. Like, let's say we start exploring for A. And now we just run DFS. We don't have to bring the extra search into the set. And, you know, here we're running this. And what we would do is just, like, whenever we visit a node, we keep track of the node we came from. So when we process B, we would keep in mind that we came from A. And we would not attempt to go back to A. The reason this is important is because, remember we said that if a node is visited from multiple places, we say that there's a cycle. Well, we don't want to do this here, right? So if we go from A to B, we have to just remember not to go back to where we came from, and just try to go in the other directions. And with that in mind, if anywhere else we visit the same node from multiple places, then we will conclude there's a cycle. For example, let's say this happens, right? So here now there's a cycle. Why will we detect it is because first we process A, you know, then so A gets the, like, you know, distance 0 from the source. Then we get B and C, distance 1 from the source. So far, B and C were unvisited before, so this is fine. Then B will visit D and E, so these were unvisited before, and this is fine. And B will not visit A, so we will not get this, like, false signal that there might be a cycle if, you know, we had traveled to A from B. And then we will do the processing from C, and when we go from C to E, we will see that E already has a parent. E's parent is already B at this point. And we will see that, like, look, we ended up connecting to another node that already had a parent. So every node does not have a unique parent. Therefore, there's a cycle here. We know that there exists this kind of cycle if a node can be reached from two places. Because each of the two nodes that this was reachable from is reachable from the destination, right? So necessarily, if we had some node that was reachable from two places, since each of these two places are reachable in some path from the source, this constitutes a cycle. Well, this is in an undirected graph. Now, you can probably anticipate, I don't want to spend any more time on the undirected graphs because the really interesting case is directed graphs. But I'm just pointing out that for the undirected graph version, you could just solve it using, like, DFS or something. Now, you can already anticipate that for a directed graph, it is not actually going to be the case that anything that looks like a ring is necessarily a cycle. Because consider something like this. It's perfectly okay here that D is being reached from two places, right? You can see why this is perfectly okay. Because there's no cycle here, right? There's no way you can actually even leave node D. So there's no loop here. It's directional. It's a flow in one direction. A, you know, goes to B and C, and B and C goes to D. This is kind of a flow in one direction, and there's no cycle here. Right, so then how do we detect that there is a cycle here? Well, let's take a short break. You know, it's kind of hot. People need some water. So let's take a short break, and then we'll come back with the algorithm for this. And it's just going to be a small variation on DFS. So we were going to look at the problem of how to detect cycles in using DFS. So it turns out that for detecting cycles in a directed graph, it's going to be really helpful to use DFS specifically. And we'll see why. So remember that like in a directed graph, something like this doesn't count as a cycle. So the problem with DFS is, you know, it would see that like we're coming from two different places here, and it would think this is probably a cycle. But it's not, right? So we really need a proper way to consider this directionality. So, well, first, you know, before we go into this, let's consider basically like what is the proof that DFS actually works? Because the same argument we can use to justify why DFS works also justifies why, you know, a slightly modified version of DFS is going to be able to detect cycles. So why does DFS work? So what do we mean by work? Okay, let's just take the version of the algorithm. Like what I want to show is like if I start at a given node, any vertex that is reachable from that node is definitely going to get visited. So in other words, if there's a path from the place where I start to a vertex, then that vertex will definitely be visited by the algorithm. In other words, I'm not going to miss anything. And of course, I don't have to worry about finding anything extra that's not there either, right? I really don't have to worry about that because, well, how am I going to find anything that's not there? There's just no links to it, right? If there's like some extra stuff out here that's not connected to anything and not reachable for me, I don't have to worry about ever, you know, getting here because I just have no information that leads me here. So as long as I can show that I visit every vertex, I'm good. All right, so, you know, how can I show that DFS will visit every vertex here? Well, in just like a general graph, suppose that we fix the starting point and we fix end vertex. So, you know, let's say I have starting point S, and I would like to know whether I'm eventually going to reach a particular vertex D. And I can ask this question for every D in the graph in turn. And of course, I might reach D via some intermediate path, I1, I2, you know, dot, 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 D, right? And there may be zero or more intermediate nodes here. And we have to make sure our DFS comes with a check that, like, if S equals D, we're definitely handling that case correctly. But that's kind of more of an edge case. Okay. So suppose what it means for this vertex to be reachable from the source is that a path like this exists. That's what it means to be reachable. That there is some path that will eventually lead to it. If there is no path, then it's not reachable. And we don't have to worry about the truth of the statement. So consider now what DFS does. DFS is going to pop S onto the stack. And DFS is not going to pop this off the stack and return until it has visited all of its neighbors, right? So we know, and we also know, that at the starting time, only this node is in the visited map. Initially, only this node is visited, and all of these we know to be unvisited. Now, here's the thing. We know that S cannot be popped off the stack until at some point the algorithm goes to this next node. And when the algorithm goes to this next node, it's going to have to pop I1 onto the stack. Right? So in other words, we can say that before the algorithm terminates, it definitely pops I1 onto the stack. But it's possible that I1 will not be the first thing it pops onto the stack because there could be multiple paths to the destination. Like it could be that, you know, there's this path, you know, I1, I2, you know, dot, 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 and then eventually leading to D. But it could be that, you know, because this path also exists, it could be that actually this edge gets traversed first because, you know, we consider DFS to traverse edges in arbitrary order. The way we wrote the algorithm is that it, you know, traverses them just in the order they're listed in the adjacency list, but that order is actually arbitrary. There's no reason to prefer one order to another. So it could be that even the, you know, the path we have to D is like this. It could be that, of course, this one is visited first by a different path. But okay, so the way we just kind of make the argument very easy and crisp is we just say, we know that at least one of these, and namely at least I1, has to be visited before S can get popped off the stack and before the algorithm can terminate. But let's not talk about I1. Let's just say which one of them. We know that it has to happen to one of these, so let's just say, you know, let there be some node that is the first one to get visited. So maybe in this case it's I2. Well, consider that node now. So let's say I2 is the first node to get visited. So, you know, you have something like this. Yeah, so let's say I2 is the first node to get visited. Now it's the case that your stack contains S and I2 at that moment in time. Or, you know, it's possible that there's some intermediate things you can travel to. So your stack now looks like this. And now we know for a fact, you know, by virtue that I2 was the first of these nodes to get visited, we know that actually, you know, all of these are still unvisited. And so, and now we can just kind of apply the same algorithm. The same argument. We can say that I2 will definitely not get removed from the stack until at least one of these gets added to the stack. And we'll keep making that argument until we shrink this list, and eventually we are forced to conclude that D will get popped onto the stack. But if, when D is popped onto the stack, D is visited, and that basically proves that D will definitely be visited by the algorithm. And because you can make this argument about any destination node D, eventually your argument leads you to conclude that as long as for any vertex to which there is a path, this algorithm concludes that you are visited. You know, you might be tempted to go with a simplified version of this proof that basically just says, okay, I1 will definitely be visited before S, you know, is popped off the stack. And then once I1 is visited, you might say, well, I2 will be visited. And that's true, but the problem is I2 might already be visited when you start visiting I1, right? Because, you know, you might have reached first and then backtracked and then something like that, right? So it's just, you know, kind of being more careful to make sure that, you know, we don't run into that problem. But I think it's a pretty simple proof, right? Like, you just know that one of these has to be visited before the algorithm can terminate. So you assume that one is popped onto the stack, and then you know that the rest is unvisited, and you kind of just apply the same argument, continuously shrinking how far you have to go until eventually, you know, you must visit D. Okay. So that's basically the proof that DFS works. Now, let's look at how, like, what happens when this is applied to a cycle that exists in a graph. So let's say here's our starting node. And let's say we have a cycle here. So here's a cycle. And then maybe there's some other nodes in the graph, like there's D and there's E. What I would like to show is that with a small modification to BFS, we can definitely find the cycle. So here's the thing. So here's our cycle. And there's some number of nodes. Consider the first of these nodes. So this is our cycle. Consider that, since the cycle is reachable from the source, there has to be some node of this cycle that is visited first, right? We don't know which one is necessarily going to be. Well, I mean, here we can see that it's going to be A, but in general, like, you know, it might be hard to determine, and it may even depend on exactly how the adjacency lists are ordered, if there's, you know, multiple ways to get there, right? So we may not know, like, exactly how it will happen. But we know that one of these nodes in the cycle has to be the first to get visited. So consider what happens when one of these nodes is the first one to be visited. At that point, right, we have some path from S, like the stack is essentially describing some path from S. Like maybe we visited some, you know, I1 intermediate node. So we had S and then we popped I1 onto the stack, and now we've gone ahead and popped A onto the stack. So there's some stack at the top of which is this A. Or, you know, like, A, let's just A be the first node visited in the cycle. It could be B, it could be C, it doesn't matter. Like, without loss of generality, suppose A is the one that's visited first, right? So, consider what happens here. At this point, right, at this point, these nodes are unvisited. Right? These nodes are unvisited. And now we can essentially, and we also know that this node has a link back to A. That's what it means to have a cycle. We know all these other nodes in the cycle are unvisited. So by the same argument as we made before, we can conclude that before A can be removed from the stack, it'll have to be the case that, you know, like take this one, it'll have to be the case that C is visited. It's basically the same argument as before. Any unreachable nodes, or any reachable nodes that are connected to the current node, you know, if there's a sequence of unvisited nodes leading up to them, will definitely be visited. So the C will definitely be visited because we're currently at A, and there is the sequence of unvisited nodes leading up to C. And, you know, by the same argument that we made before of, like, you know, saying that we'll definitely visit one of these next, and kind of continuously shrinking the window, we conclude that before A is ever popped off the stack, some events will happen here that will lead to C being added onto the stack, for sure. You know, A can't get removed until it's finished its commitment to exploring all of its neighbors. But what happens when C is on the stack? So at some point when C is on the stack, because C has to visit all of its edges, right? At some point, C will attempt to pop A onto the stack here. And what does that mean? Well, that means that if at this point we add an extra check that basically not only checks if A is visited, but also checks if A is visited because of the reason that it is already on the stack, then we detect the cycle. So what I'm showing is that this will always happen. This kind of situation will always happen in DFS. If there's any cycle, some node in that cycle has to be visited first, then the other nodes will be unvisited, which leads us to conclude that eventually, before this node is ever removed, the last node in the cycle that links to A will be popped onto the stack. And that means that if you allow this situation, you can detect the cycle by checking, like, when you see that this A is visited, don't just return immediately, but actually scan the stack to see whether A is already on the stack. And if it's on the stack, then you have proof of a cycle. Because this is proof of a cycle, right? Because as things get popped onto the stack, like, you can just read back the sort. Like, if you have this, right? The only way that B gets popped onto the stack after A is if B was actually linked to A. So that you can just recover the cycle immediately. Note, however, that just because a vertex is visited doesn't necessarily mean that there's a cycle, right? Because it could be that we pop a node onto the stack that's already visited, and we return immediately, but that node is not anywhere else in the stack. Because, like, that happens, for example, in this situation, right? That's just a situation where a node is visited, is referenced from multiple places, but there may not be a cycle. So, like, in this situation, what will happen is you will pop push A, so here's stack, and here's visited. This is a set. So first you push A onto the stack, and A is visited. You push B onto the stack, and B is visited. You push D onto the stack, and D is visited. You pop D from the stack. You pop D from the stack. And then you push C onto the stack, and now C is visited. Right, and then here's the set. You push D onto the stack, and D is already visited, so you return out immediately. So you wouldn't do any more work if there was stuff attached here. But look what happens here. When you push this D onto the stack, D is not elsewhere in a stack. So sometimes you will push something into the stack that's already visited, but the situation will be that it's not elsewhere in the stack, because it's just a node that was found from multiple places without there necessarily being a cycle. So this is the thing to understand. Like, when you don't have a cycle, this kind of situation will happen where sometimes you will visit, sometimes you will attempt to go to nodes that have already been visited. And then you will just return out. Remember that first line in our DFS implementation? If this node is visited, just return. Then you will return out. But in that case, if there was no cycle, then this D shouldn't be occurring anywhere over here. And if it is occurring somewhere else in the stack, then this is proof that there's a cycle, because look, like if this exists, then necessarily that means P was a neighbor of A, C was a neighbor of A, C could be followed, you know, traversed to from B, and you know, you could go from C to A as well. And that proves that there's a cycle. So basically, what modification to DFS is really required here? It's you have to, like, when instead of returning immediately, if you want to have like a chance to not just visit all the vertices, but actually you would like to detect a cycle if it occurs, then you have to throw in an additional step where before you return in that first line, you check if something's already in the stack. Now, you might realize, right, that scanning the stack is going to be like potentially kind of slow, right? Because there could be a lot of things on the stack. So of course we want to avoid actually scanning the stack. Plus you can't really do that if you're doing it recursively, right? Because you don't, you know, if you are implementing it recursively, you don't have access to the stack directly, right? So of course the solution is to just keep everything that's on the stack in a set. So basically, at any given time, we will be keeping everything that's on the stack as a set that we will be passing around as an additional parameter in our DFS. And whenever we're about to, you know, hit that case we had before of like, if this node is visited, therefore return, we're first going to check if it's in the set. And if it's in the set, then we're going to report a cycle. You know, I'll leave it as an exercise to determine, to like figure out how to actually print the cycle. It's not that hard. It's just you would have to, if you want to print the cycle, probably the easiest way is, in addition to maintaining the set, you also kind of have to maintain. Well, you also do have to pass around the stack so you can recover the information. It's a little bit unpleasant, but either that or you like, you know, once you detect the cycle, you kind of unwind the stack and you capture these in a list. It gets a little hairy to do that, so I'll leave it as an exercise to do it. But it's the concept is straightforward. You should be able to figure it out if you understood DFS. Just the actual coding of that may be a little bit hairy to like actually recover the cycle itself using that. But detecting it is very easy. Like as soon as you see that there's, you know, as soon as you see that you're currently at a node that is already in the stack from earlier, you know that there's a cycle. Okay, so does this make sense to people? Any questions on this kind of cycle detection idea? It's just adding an extra element to DFS where you are now additionally maintaining the stack and set so that you can search it easily. And the argument I was giving earlier is that you can be sure that this situation happens, right? You might be worried, like you might be worried, like can it ever be that there's a cycle in the graph? But just by like coincidence, based on the order in which the nodes are traversed, because you know when a vertex has multiple outbound edges, they're traversed in arbitrary order, right? Could it be that even though there's a cycle, this situation will never happen? That you know by coincidence, you will never get this stack that has you know two of the same nodes in it. And that was the argument I was making, that no, like that can't happen because one of the vertices in the cycle has to be the first one to be visited, and then you know that all of the unvisited vertices in the cycle are going to get visited if A was the first vertex to get visited, you know, all the other vertices of the cycle will be visited before A has a chance to be popped off, which means that eventually you'll end up at this one that links to A, and then eventually you will push A onto the stack. And now we're ready to discuss why. Remember we were talking about marking earlier, how instead of having like sets or visited maps, you could store a property in the node, right? And we talked about like a node can be marked or unmarked. And I also mentioned at that time that in some textbooks they have an implementation where every node is marked either white, black, or gray. So what's that all about? Well, actually, that's exactly what this is about. So if you want to do the cycle detection, you have to mark nodes one of three values, right? So there's a node can be visited, a node can be visited and in the stack, and a node could, or a node can be unvisited, right? Those are the possible states. Like if a node is if a node is on the stack, then it is definitely visited. But a node could be visited and not on the stack any longer because it got popped off. It might have been on the stack in the past, right? A node cannot, however, be on the stack and be unvisited, right? Because the very first time it's popped onto the stack, it's marked as visited. So that means there's essentially three states. There's unvisited, which I think most textbook implementations refer to that one as white. Like unvisited, like completely unmarked. That's probably why it's white. Then there's gray, which gray is basically it's on the stack. It's visited and it's still on the stack. And then black is like it's visited and it's no longer on the stack. It's been popped off. So the way that normally works is the first time you visit a node, you change it from white to gray. And then when you pop that node off the stack, when you are like finished exploring all of the nodes that node leads to, and you're actually popping the node off the stack, then you change it from gray to black. So basically nodes evolve in kind of this process. Like a node changes from white to gray when it's first popped onto the stack, and it changes from gray to black when it's popped off the stack. But that's just another way of implementing the logic we already discussed. Okay. I would like to, you know, cover like one more topic, then I'll take any remaining questions on DFS, and then we'll go on to topological sort, which is a very exciting topic. So the last thing I want to cover about DFS is essentially time complexity. Like, what's the time complexity of the algorithm? So remember, DFS has basically a line that prevents the method really from doing anything much at all if the node has been visited before, right? So essentially, it means that all of the time complexity of DFS is essentially in that loop that it has. Like, if the node was not visited before, right? So you have like, you know, like if you have like if visited return, and then you have, you know, if you don't return, then you have that for loop, right? Like basically for each edge in the node's adjacency list, you know, for each edge, you did something here. Right? And what you did was to call another recursive method. So the best way to calculate the time complexity of this, it seems kind of tricky, right? Because it's like a recursive method that calls itself multiple times. But really the time complexity analysis here has the same justification as all of the like dynamic programming time complexity analyses. Now, you don't have to know dynamic programming to understand this session. But if you do know dynamic programming, if you remember how, like, in the top-down implementation, we basically say that what we're going to do is we're going to count the amount of time spent in this function, but we are not going to count any time spent calling other instances of the same function, because we're going to count those separately. If you remember that analysis from, like, top-down dynamic programming, this is exactly the same thing. Let me kind of briefly go over it for people who are not familiar with that analysis. So, like, you know, this is just a very rough sketch. This is like, you know, so this is the DFS helper method. And remember, here we call like DFS helper with some other arguments, right? So the idea here is we're going to count the amount of time taken in this method, but we are not going to count any amount of time that is taken in other functions. And we'll see why not. It's because that will be counted elsewhere. So what we're going to do is we're going to argue this method can be called at most once for every node. Well, other than the ones that just hit this case, but we'll deal with that separately. So this part of the method can only be visited like once for each node. So if what we do is we don't count the amount of time spent in here, but we just count the amount of time spent in this very method, and then we multiply that by the total number of distinct nodes it can be called with, which is the number of nodes that are reachable from the source, then we have our time complexity. So like in other words, we won't try to count this here directly. We'll just say oh yeah, this invokes this function, so we'll even like we'll even count like an order one function. We'll count like an order one term of like setting up the function call, basically. But we won't actually count any time spent inside this function because it's counted elsewhere. We're counting this once for each node, so whatever happens here, whatever this calls, it'll be counted somewhere else. And this is just the same justification we used for top-down dynamic programming, if you remember. How much time does this actually spend in here? Well, this is a constant time check. What about this line? Well, this does have to like update a local variable for as many times as you have edges, right? And it does have to set up a function call, which takes order one time, but it has to do that once for each edge, right? So this is order num edges, like where this is the number of edges that the vertex has. So this takes time proportional to the number of edges the vertex has in its adjacency list. So what is the total time complexity? Well, let's sum up order number of edges with the number of vertices, right? So basically, we are saying that the total time complexity is, like, what does order mean? It means it's like some constant multiplied by, it's bounded by some constant multiplied by the number of edges of vertex one plus some constant. You know, now we're adding the time spent in every occurrence of this method. Number of edges of V2, right? Dot, dot, dot. But what is this total sum? Like, let's root this constant C out of these brackets. And this goes up to vertex N. What is this sum? This sum is the total number of edges in the graph. That's just the total sum of the total size of the input, right? Total size of the adjacency list. So all of this is equal to E, the number of edges in the graph. So now we have that the time complexity is bounded by C times E, and that means that this is order E. So this is just like DFS, it runs in linear time, it runs in order E. Now you might say, oh wait a second, we have a problem, right? What about this? I arbitrarily decided not to count this. I said that I would only invoke, you know, every function would only be invoked once with the same argument, but that's not true, because you might be invoking this over and over again for the same node. But actually, you realize that this is just like a way of making the code cleaner. What you could have done is you could have moved that check to here, and it would conceptually be the same logic, right? Like, if you move that check over here to check if this is visited before you ever invoke it, that would actually be like executing essentially the same program control flow. It would just, you know, be written a little differently, and you would be able to more clearly see that, okay, because this is an order one check, it doesn't affect the analysis. But we write it over here just because it's simpler and it's easier. But basically, like, just think of, like, whenever you hit this logic, attribute this time complexity to the caller. Just do that. Like, attribute this time complexity to the caller that cause these lines to be executed, and then because it's still order one per invocation, that same argument still applies and it's order E. And this is exactly the same justification as we used for top-down dynamic programming. You know, again, like down to this very like line of argument about is it okay to check arguments here in return? Like exactly the same line of argumentation. Yeah, it's kind of nice if you already know like a little bit of, at least basics about dynamic programming for this session. And in fact, maybe later we'll see like a little bit about. It turns out that in a very beautiful way, dynamic programming is very directly connected to topological sort. But you don't actually have to know dynamic programming to understand topological sort. So don't worry. Like I didn't make it a prerequisite for this session, but that's okay. So you know, time complexity is order E. Now, you might ask, okay, so BFS is order E, DFS is order E, so whether you search breadth first, you know, it's called breadth first search because it's like a flood fill, right? Flooding out, you know, in kind of a wavefront format, you know, visiting these first and then visiting this. And depth first search is the opposite, right? It's like depth first search first runs as deep as it can and then backtracks, that's why those algorithms are called what they are. And you might say BFS is order E. And DFS is order E. Like, both algorithms are order E. So why should you prefer one over the other? Well, first of all, remember that DFS can give you the shortest path. That is like a really important property. So that is, you know, like, if you need the shortest path, you must use DFS. It's very easy to see that there's no reason why DFS would give you the shortest path if you try to apply it in that way. Because, like, let's take a look. Like, you know, let's say this is the shortest path from source to destination, right? You have no guarantee that DFS will even go to this one first, right? It could be that DFS takes this route, you know, because the adjacency lists are in arbitrary order. It could totally be that DFS goes here first and then goes around and only then hits this, right? So there's no reason why DFS would ever give you the shortest path. So if you need the shortest path, you have to use DFS. What if you don't? So the cases where you don't is either cases where you just need to check the connectivity between two nodes, or like find a path between two nodes, like find a path between S and D, or the case where, you know, you want to just find like all the nodes that are connected to S, right? You want to find like kind of like connected components problems, like that classic problem where, you know, you have a grid of ones and zeros, and you have to find like all of the connected chains of ones, like, you know. Like, and here, you know, you would be expected to detect the fact that there's two connected islands. Like, there's this connected island, and there's this connected island. And, you know, we already solved that problem in one of the past problem-solving sessions, but I want to point out that, you know, well, this was actually solved, like, we saw the solution to this in, like, graphs part two that we did, or part three, one of them. You know, I just want to point out that this can be solved using depth first search as well, because here we don't really care about finding the shortest path. Here what we do is we just, you know, we scan this grid for an initial starting one, and here we find it. And then we just go until we, you know, can't find any more connected ones. And DFS can do that just like breadth first search can as well. You know, and then when you find all these ones, you kind of mark them down, and then you keep scanning for ones that are not marked, and then eventually you find, you know, you find this one, and then you traverse all of these. And that's how that algorithm works. And we showed last time that this is still a linear time algorithm and all that. I'm not going to repeat all of that, but just, you know, be aware that like problems like that are either about just connectivity and that don't require you to find the shortest path, generally you have a choice. Breadth first search or depth first search. Now, which one should you choose? Well, depth first search is normally implemented recursively. It doesn't have to be. Remember I told you the story about the reader aware you choose the scaled goosebumps series, and remember I said how, you know, I was solving it by like jotting down the stack explicitly, like jotting down the page numbers on a piece of paper. And of course you could simulate that too by, you know, you know instead of using recursion, you would, you know, push and pop off a stack yourself in order to backtrack. So depth first search does not have to be implemented recursively, but usually the reason people use it, one of the big factors is that it's so simple, right? It was like five lines of code. And for it to be simple like that, you have to use recursion. So one of the disadvantages of DFS is usually it ends up being recursive. And, you know, as you know, sometimes recursive solutions can be a little bit slower than the iterative solutions just because of the overhead of like making all those functions. So often, like, if you really want to like maximize your performance, you may actually prefer to do breadth first search.